like this heterogeneity idea using NIR imaging. Oh, did I get it? So I want to let you know that this work has been done with a very important contribution of Rodrigo Rocha. Rodrigo Rocha is a PhD student of mine from Brazil, very clever guy. And well, we came together with some concepts that we thought could be interesting to show to you today. Okay. So.
With this scroll.
Oh, no, it's fine. It's fine also. So the outline of this talk will be, first of all, about trying to explain the connection between the imaging measurement and the heterogeneity concept. And I want to describe a little bit what we interpret as heterogeneity, paying attention to two different aspects, because as you will see, heterogeneity is a complex concept, and we have to look at different things to define it properly. Once we explain that, and we explain some kind of indices that can help us to understand the different sides of heterogeneity, I will try to explain how we can use these indices to monitor in real time blending processes, which is actually nothing else than a reflection of how heterogeneity changes as a function of time. Okay, good. So let's start. And it is true that nowadays, when you are in an industrial context and you want to check the quality of a product, we want to look at the physical properties of this project, of this product, at the chemical properties. And if we go many years back, when people were thinking about composition, most of the times they were taking a sample, they were putting it in solution, making some kind of measurements to know what they had and in which amount. And that was a kind of a bulk measurement. So, okay, it just reflected with a number all the variability of the properties that we can have in a sample. With time, and more, this composition concept has become a little bit more complex. And people want to know whether the composition of a sample changes in time, because stability is important. But they also want to know whether it changes in space, because if I have a complex sample, thinking that the composition in a certain area is going to be identical to the composition in another area is also a little bit unrealistic. And this is very much connected with this heterogeneity concept. Am I always having more or less the same, or I have a huge variability within my sample? Then, of course, if you think about some kind of measurement that can tell us about chemical information and spatial information, images come immediately to our mind, because this is the kind of beautiful analytical measurement where we have a chemical idea, not of the bulk of the sample, but with a spatial definition behind. Okay, this is why we thought, okay, let's use this kind of hyperspectral images to describe heterogeneity. Of course, I will show examples of near infrared, but you need to think that any kind of vision system can be suitable for what I will explain later on, either color or Raman systems or any other kind of imaging system. I guess almost everyone knows what a hyperspectral image is, but in case someone here on the other side of the screen doesn't know, is a way to define from a chemical point of view, especially our sample. So as in any picture, we will have pixels that cover the surface of our sample. And the difference is that in this case, per every pixel, we will have a full spectrum. So we will have an information related to the chemistry of that particular area that I am studying in my image, okay? Of course, as most of you know, nowadays we have imaging systems using many kinds of spectroscopies and spectrometries, because we also have mass spectrometry imaging, and this can be used in many different contexts, okay? So this is our image. This is an enormous amount of spectra, thousands, even millions, depending on the kind of platform that we can have. But it is true that if we want to interpret what is inside this initial big amount of spectra, well, now I'm a little bit ashamed of that because I know that I should put Booger first, so please forgive me about that. I will change it from now on in all my slides. But anyway, let's say that if we have this this image, okay, even if we display it as a cube, this is nothing else than many, many, many spectra. And many times when we want to define the information that we have in this kind of cube, we tend to put all the pixel spectra one under the other one, and then we say, okay, the information that this contains is actually the reflection of the Booger-Verlander law. So any pixel spectrum can be explained as a combination of the pure spectral signatures of the components in the sample, weighted in every pixel by the contribution that each one of these components has. Of course, if we look at these concentration profiles that here are strengths, if we just put them again, mimicking the spatial position that they have in the image, we can have concentration maps. And this is giving us an idea about how much of a certain component we have and how it is distributed in the space, okay? So this is our measurement. This is what we would like to have. And the good news, and I will not expand today on that, is that there are many chemometric tools that can help us to go from this original situation here, where we have this thousand of pixel spectra, into this nice model that is giving us a lot of chemical information in terms of the identity of components with the spectral fingerprints, and these concentration maps, which are depicting the amount of the compounds that we have and how they distribute in the space, okay? Of course, if we look at these maps, immediately, just by eye, we can tell whether our compounds are distributed in a more or less heterogeneous way. Everybody here will say, okay, if I see these three maps, it looks like this one is a little bit, this component is a little bit less heterogeneous, this map, than these other ones because the agglomerations are bigger, just by eye. The idea is, can we use these maps to come up with some kind of quantitative index? Because qualitatively we are very good, but in real life we cannot say, well, this is more or less, this is not useful. Okay? Good. So with this idea, first of all, what I will tell you is we have to come up with ways to define what heterogeneity is in a quantitative way, or to think what heterogeneity is. And now it comes this different size heterogeneity. And this is very much connected with this sampling theory that Alexandre was mentioning this morning by Piaget, reinterpreted by Kim Svensson. Then the first thing I want to show you is our most traditional way to define heterogeneity when we have a map, a concentration map. An easy thing to do is taking the concentration values that we have in the different pixels, and we can make a histogram. Okay, so if there is a lot of a scatter in the values that we have, we say, okay, this is more heterogeneous. And if we have a very small scatter, we say, okay, this is less heterogeneous. So in this way, we can just see the scatter between the concentration values that we have in every individual piece, in every little portion of material. And in this case, you have again two maps. And here, well, the relative variance associated with this histogram is lower than this one. So we can say, okay, this global heterogeneity in this case grows in this direction. But is this everything we can have a look at when we talk about heterogeneity? And the answer is no. And I will show you a nice example connected now only with this map. Look at these figures here. This is a real map of caffeine, of concentration values. This map that you have on the right contains exactly the same concentration values as here, but they are put in random positions, okay? So this map and this map will provide the same histogram because I'm working with the same concentration values. But if I had not explained that and I was asking you which map gives you an idea of lower heterogeneity, Everybody would say that one. So this means that if we only look at the concentrations in the pixels, we are missing something with respect to heterogeneity. And this is what we call distributional heterogeneity. So it is not only about the scattering, the concentration values that we have, but it is also, we also have to look at how evenly distributed the material is. That's something else, okay? Because here I have the same concentration values, but I have agglomerations with many pixels with high concentration, and then agglomerations with pixels with low concentration. And of course, these two maps, even if they have the same concentration values, they have very different distributional heterogeneities. In this case, this is this kind of distributional heterogeneity is lower than here, because here everything looks much more uniform from a spatial point of view than in this case here. So let's try to quantify the two things, because both are important. Okay, and the way to try to come up with indicators for these two different kinds of heterogeneity is this variographic analysis, and I will show you how to use it to come up with indices. First of all, I want to tell you what a variogram is, and especially related to an image or to a map. So we are going to work always with these concentration maps. That's our starting information. And then a variogram is a statistical tool that represents the variation of pixel concentration variance as a function of a distance. And of course, the idea of variance here is calculated slightly in a different way. The way to calculate variance, for instance, for a distance between pixels of one, is taking all the pairs of pixels that are separated by the same distance in both directions of the image. I will see how different the concentrations are, and I will make kind of an average. Okay? This is the way of doing it. This is when I compare pixels that are consecutive, but I will do it comparing pairs of pixels that are separated into units, then three, four, and so forth. And what I will get at the end, in general, is this kind of picture, which is telling me that if I have a map where I have some agglomerations, of course, if I compare pixels that are very close together, the concentrations are going to be more similar than if I compare pixels that are very far away. Okay? What will happen if I have samples where these agglomerations are very big? This kind of tendency that says, okay, the variance increases when my distance increases, this kind of evolution will stay much, much longer if I have big agglomerations. If the agglomerations are very low, are very small, sorry, I will have a much steeper increase, and then this will level up, okay? We will use these ideas to extract these indices. Not the parameters directly, maybe, but these ideas. Just for you to know, this distance in which we find this kind of correlation with the distance, with the variance, we call it range. And this value of variance, where more or less everything stays constant, it is called sigma. This is just nomenclature, okay? Here I show you the three maps that I showed you before, and have a look. Clearly we were saying, well, this looks less heterogeneous than those other maps. And as we can see here, the agglomerations are bigger, and this is why this kind of increase stays back for a much more longer distance, okay? Because the correlation is bigger. Okay. Now, have a look. Now I go to the other idea that we saw before. This is the cafe map, and this is the randomized map, and same concentrations. Here I have my variogram, okay, reflecting the presence of these little agglomerations. And of course, when all these pixels are distributed in a random way, it doesn't matter that I compare pixels that are very close together or very far away from each other, because they are going to be equally similar. There's no correlation, there's no agglomeration here. This is the kind of variogram that I will have in a situation of ideal mixing, okay? So it's a good reference to know how far I am from having something with a very uniform distribution. Now let's see how we can use these variograms to define this global heterogeneity aspect and the distributional heterogeneity aspect. If it is about just taking into account the scatter of concentration values, I can directly use this kind of variable. I can do that. This value of variance, the limit here, this will give me directly the global heterogeneity index. It's very important to know that if you were doing maths, this value corresponds exactly to the value of variance that we will calculate with our calculator inputting all the concentration values and doing a normal calculation of the variance. Okay, so it's exactly the same. So for this kind of index, we are done. We do it in a classical way, if you want. What about the distributional heterogeneity? It will be nice to compare these two variables and to see how far away this one is from this one. So nice thing to, a good way to do it is, now they are in the same kind of plot. This is for the same material. And then what I can do, an easy way to quantify how far away I am from the ideal situation is, I can take the area below this randomized variagram. I can take this area and I can do the ratio. If the ratio is equal to one, it means that the two variables are exactly equal, and then my mixing is ideal. If these values get lower, it's that I'm more far away from the ideal situation. It can be 0.8. Okay, you have an 80% of the ideal mixing. No, 50% or not. And this is, again, for this same situation, we can see that when we have bigger agglomerations, so less uniform distribution, this kind of index drops, okay, representing this idea, which is only related to how my material distributes, not how big is the scatter between concentration values. Okay? Good, so those are the kind of indices that we will use, because they reflect different aspects of heterogeneity. Now let's see how can we use that in a continuous monitoring of a blending process. How can I adapt this idea to this context? And well, we came up with a nice acronym that Rodrigo invented, which is this sliding window variographic image analysis. And I will show you how it works. So the idea that we will do, or that we did actually in the lab, was monitoring a mixing process, a blending process. And we had some components in a vial. It was a glass vial that was rotating. And then we had an NIR camera at the bottom, and that was collecting lines of pixel spectra as long as this was turning, okay? So in the very beginning, we have the material which is very separated, but as soon as we mix, this gets more and more uniform because things really get much better this time, okay? So what we will have is a very, very, very long map, and we would like to have an idea about how this heterogeneity changes as a function of time in this case. So what can we do? Well, essentially, we will do two steps. The first one is, from these lines of pixel spectra, we want to convert this information into lines of pixel concentrations for the different compounds in the mix. So this is what we want, because we have to construct the map for every component. And the second thing we will do is, these longer maps, we will try to have to come up with an idea to study them in sections as a function of time and see how these indices related to heterogeneity change. Okay? So that's the idea. This is our situation. This is our moment in our blending. We collect a line of pixel spectra. This is the spectra that we can collect in this line, maybe hundreds of them, depending on the kind of system that you have. And of course, like in any other methodology, we get some spectra, we do some pre-processing to correct for scattering, etc. We did, in this case, it was a derivative. I don't remember whether it was first or second, but okay, we pre-process the data. And then, since we are working with mixtures in which we know what we put there, it's not a surprise. We know what it is because it's a product that we make. We took images from pure components. We made an average, okay? And remember the law of the Bugger, the Lambert law. if I have my spectra and I have the pure fingerprints of each one of the components, I can derive these pixel concentration values very easily in a single step. So this is what I would have. I start with my line of spectra, and I end up with three lines. In this case, it was a mixture of three components, three lines of concentrations. Of course, every time I collect a new line, I will have a new line of concentrations per each one of the components that I had. Okay? Now, what we will do? When we have monitored a certain amount of time, we will use this kind of map that is related to a certain time window, and we will derive the heterogeneity indices. And then we will just scroll this window one line ahead. So the idea is the following one. Well, this is just to remind in this context the definition of the indices, but you know it by now, so I will pass that. And now here, that's the idea. I have this, you should think that this is the map of a particular compound, the concentration map. If I take this first window, I will get the two indices, and now I would move the window one line ahead in time, and then I would do that as long as I am collecting pixel lines as a function of the blending time. And finally, what I will have is a picture like this one, which is telling me how my global heterogeneity index, if there is a good mixing, is decreasing as a function of time, because the pixel concentration values will be every time more similar. And also how this distributional uniformity index is getting better and better because my material is more evenly distributed. And this is a way to do in real time this kind of procedure. A good thing about it is that, well, I didn't mention it before, but for instance, to process one of these lines, you have enough with less than 0.1 second. So it's really fast. Now, when you try to implement this kind of way to look at heterogeneity, there are two parameters that you have to think about when you do this monitoring in real time. Is this a problem? No, this is flexibility of the method, because it allows you to adapt to the way you want to look at heterogeneity in your particular process. So it's not fixed parameters, you can tune. The first parameter that we can think of is the window size. So how big should be these blending time rates that I analyze to derive my indices? And we can get, for instance, for a particular time, that would be the last line that we collect with the imaging system, I can just take few lines, let's say previous to the last line that I'm measuring, or I can make big windows if I want to take into account more past observations in my system. Does it have some influence? Of course it has, because in a way, if I take this big window and I try to derive, for instance, a global heterogeneity index, well, here the pixel concentration values are much more similar than very, very far away, okay? Whereas if I'm taking a small window, they will be more or more similar. So how can we tune that? Here what you have is, in this case, the evolution of this distributional uniformity index using these three window sizes, okay? What it happens is that if we take a very, very big window size and we compare it with results obtained with shorter window sizes, we will see that there is a certain delay in seeing the heterogeneity evolution. Why? Because we are taking into consideration times or lines of pictures that are very far away from my current time. So we should not overdo that. Let's keep it in a reasonable space. It is not very nice either to get very, very small windows, because then we can see very local phenomena which are not very interesting for us either. So we should come up with a window that is sufficiently big to really represent what is the heterogeneity at a certain moment, but not too big, because otherwise we will see all the evolution a little bit later than we should. So it depends on the time resolution that you want to describe your heterogeneity, okay? Without being too long, and then miss some events. There's another important parameter, and is that, for instance, imagine that I want to control the mixing of a pharmaceutical blending and the mixing of a food product. Okay, that I put several things and then this is given to animals or whatever. It is obvious that heterogeneity will be much more critical in a pharmaceutical product than in this kind of food. Okay? Which means also that the spatial scale at which I want to see whether my product is heterogeneous or not can be much smaller in a pharmaceutical compound than in a food product, where it is not so relevant that at a scale of 100 microns everything looks the same. I don't need that. So you can also tune this kind of methodology depending on the scale of spatial scrutiny that you want. Okay. And in this case, for instance, what I will show you is the variograms that you see here, from which we can derive indices, are built looking at, this is the maximum distance that we look at between pixels. Okay, it's 25 millimeters in this case. And this is the index that I have. That's my scale. That's my distance scale and goes till this point. If I want to be more strict and say, no, 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 I want something less heterogeneous in a smaller area, then it means that I will only look at how these pixels behave at maximum at this distance from one another. Have a look at the consequence of that. It means that my variogram will be cut here. And of course, the ratio between this area and this area is different than if I am going more farther away in distance and I compare this full area with this one. But again, we can tune this parameter depending on how fine we want to be in the spatial description of heterogeneity. And now just to end, what I want to show you is some real cases, what comes up. And to do that, what we were doing was some mixtures using food products of different particle sizes, shapes, like these poppy seeds, quinoa seeds, ground coffee, it's very different. And also kind of a pharmaceutical blend using starch, which has a very small particle size, and then acetyl salicylic and citric acid, and see what happens. This is a little bit the setup. I described it before, so I will not repeat it. And this is an example. This is the initial situation from this kind of food blend with all the components completely separated in layers. And this is how it looks like in reality. So that's the camera, which is at the bottom. And then you can just connect this blender, and now and then we are collecting frames from the bottom of the vial, covering the full length of the vial. Now, in this case, this is this food mixture, what I will show you here. These are the concentration maps of the three components, but they are overlaid because this makes it easier to see what happens. And at the bottom, you will see how this distributional index is changing as long as this blending takes place, okay? You see that the components every time mix a little bit together, and this is reflected in the increase of this index. So every time we are going more closer to what an ideal mixing would be. And of course, it depends on every component. Not all components distribute so easily in a uniform way. It depends on many different parameters. And what I was telling you before, for windows that have more than 1,000 lines of pixel spectra with 500 pixels in every one, the way to process the getting the indices is, you can see it's a very short time. So you can do this in real time, it's feasible. Now, just to end up quickly, this is an example of replication of the same mixture. And of course, it is very important to control these two different kinds of indices, because even if we mix the same, the blending should not necessarily evolve in the same way. This is a little bit perhaps going maybe not against, but these mechanistic models that they say, okay, if you have to use with this particle size, this will evolve in this way, or maybe not in practice. In this case, you can see that for the blending run that you have here, those are like snapshots related to different times, and the maps that you can see. Here we have a very nice mixing because from a distributional point of view, we reach for all components a very good value. And also this global heterogeneity decreases and gets stabilized. Whereas on the right-hand side, we reach a stable value for this distributional uniformity index, but for some components, this is low. And this is telling us also that when we talk about blending, say if this sample is well blended or not, maybe you have to look at a component level, because it may happen that some components are very easy to be blended. And if it is your critical component, maybe you can be very lucky and you don't care about the other things in there. But assuming the same kind of behavior for all what you have in a sample, that's not true. And here, for instance, you can see that the boxes, those are spherical. In general, they tend to easily distribute in a uniform way. But for instance, in the case of ground, coffee, and quinoa, in this case, everything went well. And in this other case, you can see, look at the map, at the final map, and you can see very easily that the green material, which is the ground coffee, goes to one side of the map, and the blue material goes to the other side. You must think that the vial is in this direction. So if for some reason that vial was a little bit tilted, it's very easy that one component went to one side and the other one to the other side. In this case, this is more critical for ground coffee and quinoa. Why? Because the physical properties of these two components are extremely different. One is very big, the other one is very small, one is much more dense than the other one. So this segregation phenomena is much easier that it happens between these two components than with the other one. So take a look at that because, I mean, it's important to understand how every component behaves. And now I want to show you a last system, and with this I will conclude. This is a mixture of acetyl salicylic, citric acid, and starch. And here we have our indices per component, the distributional one, the global heterogeneity index. I always talked about indices per component. Of course, you can do like a pooled index that is kind of an average between all the components that you have. And you can have like total mixture indices if you want as well. But for instance, in this case, it is important to see that again, if I look at the starch, I do not have any problem in getting a uniform distribution in my product. But if I look at acetyl salicylic and to a less extent, but also citric acid, I see that things go well and then all of a sudden, the blending gets worse. And this is real. I mean, this is what we call a demixing phenomenon. And this has been reported. I mean, it's not that one day we had a bad luck and we saw a weird thing. We have studied many, many systems and this happens. Which means that, of course, if we are able to see this evolution, we can end up with the idea that the more we blend, the better. Well, not always. Sometimes you have to stop at a certain time. And one possible way to use these indices is also to say, hey, you reach a point, don't continue, because first of all, you will save time if you stop here. And even more important, maybe if you continue too much, it will be worse. So try to stop at the right time, to save time and to ensure a certain quality for your product, okay? And well, with this, I think that's enough, okay? And I just wanted to show that, you know, that we can interpret this heterogeneity in a quantitative way, that it depends on components, it depends on runs. So please monitor everything. Don't rely only on theoretical models that will tell you how things mix. And finally, saying that, I mean, these indices, we have not done it yet, but it is very easy to think about some kind of process control based on the use of these indices, individually or combined. Kind of a motor response chart based on the combination of these two pieces. And this is all. Thank you.